fellowship, we can honor your word coming true about the birth of your son. Lord, we pray that we can celebrate it with honor and love. But Lord, we can also reflect on the years past and how when we're with our families and stuff, how we can share. Lord, we just give you thanks and you honor. We pray that you take this offering and go a long way to meet the needs of this church. Lord, in Christ's name, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Let's all stand up one more time. We'll turn to page 521 in your hymnal. One of my favorite songs we sing when somebody gets saved or baptized, there's a new name in glory. Page 521. I was once a sinner, but I came, pardon to receive from my Lord. This was freely given, and I found that he always kept his word. There's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. And the white-robed angels sing the story. A sinner has come home, for there's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. With my sins forgiven, I am bound for heaven, never more to roam. I was humbly kneeling at the cross, fearing not but God's angry frown. When the heavens opened and I saw that my name was written down, there's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. With the white-robed angels sing the story, a sinner has come home, for there's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. With my sins forgiven, I am bound for heaven, never more to roam. On the last, in the book 'tis written, saved by grace, oh, the joy that came to my soul. Now I am forgiven, and I know, by the blood I am made whole. There's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. And the white-robed angels sing the story, a sinner has come home. But there's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. With my sins forgiven, I am bound for heaven, never more to go. good singing. Let's do one more. We'll do our blue folder song, page 346. I know my name is there. I feel like that heat's working extra good today. Might want to turn it down. Woo. My name is in the book of life. Oh, bless the name of Jesus. I rise above all doubt and strife and read my title clear. I know, my name is there. I know, my name is written there. My name
It's always warmer up here, Josh. We can go to the book of Luke, chapter 2, verse number 7. And it's that time of year we're going to talk about Christmas. Anybody ever heard of Christmas? You talk to some people, it's like a disease. Oh, shoot, I got Christmas. Oh, my goodness, I get that off. Yeah. I mean, scares them to death for some reason. What is that? I seen some guy post this week on Facebook, and he said, if your church has a Christmas tree, a pagan spirit has just entered your church. You better run. I was in a church yesterday. I had hundreds of Christmas trees in there. I was thinking, man, I'm in trouble in here, boy. These demon spirits are everywhere. The truth is, Christmas tree represents Chris. Chris is Christ. You see what I'm saying? And when people look at a Christmas tree or when they look at Christmas in general, the nativity, whatever it may be, the lights, it always represents Christianity. And it's they think Christmas is a very spiritual religious holiday, where Christians look at it and say, well, yeah, it is, but it's pretty pagan, you know. And, you know, they've commercialized everything, and, you know, it's all about how many gifts we can give more than you know, the spirit of the season about a Savior. But honestly, you know, Christmas to me is a joy. And I enjoy Christmas. I'm not a Jehovah Witness. I don't mind. I put a Christmas tree up. Santa Claus has never scared me. Him and I have been friends for 70 years. And, you know, I've never woke up in the night worrying whether Santa Claus is in my house or not. And he's a pretty good spirit, whatever he is. And they said, but he's too much like Christ. Was that a bad thing? Are we supposed to be like Christ? Amen. That's what I'm thinking. That's not really a bad thing, you know. He said, but the people will think he's a type of Christ. Huh. We'll start calling him, instead of saint, we'll call him Christian. Type of Christ is a Christian, right? So he'd be Chris Kringles, right? Is that Santa Claus? Well, that's part of Christian. And then Santa is the root word for saint. Saint Claus, you know. He's not a bad guy. But how many of you know, are there any kids in here? Just you. I'm going to tell you, I'm going to break it to you slowly. Santa Claus is not real. Don't pass out, Megan. But there's a lot of them. And so even though Santa can't be everywhere at the same time like we make him out to be, there's a whole lot of Santa Clauses out there. And one comes to my house every year. He's never failed yet that I know of. And you probably have one that comes to your house, and there's one at the street corner, one down at the shopping mall, one about every store you go in. And we had a parade here yesterday, didn't we? Came through Delhi, because I noticed all the traffic was blocked off. And we had to go to a ballet yesterday for the kids in the Cincinnati Christian Dance Academy, and it was really good. And we ran into that, and they had all the roads blocked off. I said, "Uh-oh, either a politician's coming through, or we're having a parade today." And so I just started waving at people, like I was part of it. Hey, how's everybody doing? Well, and they waved back, you know, I like that. Yeah, they thought we was really part of it. Like, he's leading it, look at him. I didn't have a sign, I pulled it out. Del High Hills, Baptist Church, I mean. Put a big sign on top of the car like we're in that parade, you know. That's all right, guys. Anyway, today, I'm not talking about Santa Claus or any of those things. I'm going to be talking about a baby. We're going to take a walk down Manger Street. You thought I said Main Street, didn't you? We're going to walk down Manger Street. And Manger Street, that's because this baby that came was born in a manger. You know, a manger is just a feeding trough. It's where you take your animals, put some hay in there, maybe some oats and things like that, some seed, and they just like to eat that stuff. And you can feed your animals there. And so, there's something funny about this, and I'll read the verse, Luke 2, verse number 7. She brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in a swaddling cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. And that's it. I mean, you just read that verse by yourself sometime, sitting alone thinking about the Lord, and see how sad that verse hits you. There was no room for them. You know, we always read it wrong, don't we? If you notice, it's not because we read him in the first clause there where it says, laid him in a manger. We always read him in the second one, too, because there was no room for, but it's them. There's no room for them in the end. And we always think there's no room for him. There's no room for him either. But it was no room for none of them. You see, it don't only affect, this birth didn't only affect the baby. But it also affect those connected to him. And in this case, his mom and dad, well, stepdad. And they were affected by his birth also in a negative way. This verse is pretty negative in a lot of ways. I always call myself, you know, the blue-collar pastor. Because I always stand up for the blue-collar guy, you know, and a hard-working guy. I think they're the backbone of our nation. And, you know, in my opinion, nobody works harder than blue-collar workers. I've been in a lot of offices, and I feel like, do you guys get paid for this? You ought to go out there where I'm at. You know what I'm saying? I got this machine running and this machine running, and 10 people standing on my back wanting this and wanting that. And then I walk in the office, and my boss is, that blue-collar worker, you know, he's doing it. He's the guy way up there on that crane. You know, he's the guy stretching them high wires across that valley. He's the guy built that railroad bridge across the river and those canyons and all those things. Those guys are something else. They don't get paid enough. I don't know how we could turn things around where the blue-collar worker gets paid the most. His job is the most dangerous and the hardest and so forth and so on, and the white-collar worker would have to look up to him. Hey, here comes that plumber. That plumber would be all dressed as blues. I got my plumbing uniform on, and that executive would say, boy, now there's a plumber right there. I wish I could plumb. And there's a carpenter. I wish I was a carpenter. You know the thing about Jesus is he was a blue-collar worker.
Amen.
That's why when I asked you a couple questions today, and one of them is, what's wrong with this picture? But the other question would be, why did it have to take place? I mean, if I was God and that was my baby, this doesn't seem like what I would do. Of course, God's ways far above our ways. We don't understand him because he don't do things like we do. But if this was my baby and I was God and I owned everything, I mean, I could have had the best display ever was when my baby came into this world. I could have fallen stars and fireworks, man, and maybe planets blowing up. You know, and I said, what is all that? My baby's being born today. He's the Savior of the world, the King of kings, the Lord of lords. And you just feel like a something really good, but that's not what God did he? God said, and you know, you gotta, if you believe God's sovereign, then you absolutely know that God was involved in this, and he brought this thing about.
Amen.
It wasn't like that, it was all a surprise to God that his baby, his son, his only begotten son, was born in a stable. And so when you look at those things, you think, my goodness, surely a God that created everything could do better than that for his boy. And I know he could, but he didn't want to. There's no doubt in my mind God could have done anything he wanted to, but that's not what the point was here. If you remember who the Lord came looking for, then you pretty well know. He came as a servant. He came looking for the sinner. He came looking for the sick. He came looking for those who needed the physician, not the physician himself. You know, I was thinking that this morning, how many people that I probably won to Christ from when I first got into the ministry till today, and I know there was thousands. But I don't ever remember winning a doctor. I don't remember winning a lawyer to the Lord. My buddy Bill Raines over at Missions Baptist, he won a doctor last week. He was out, and you know, he wondered, you know, why God did what he did. You know, Tim, his son, has been in a coma now for four or five years. And it's not a coma, he's just in a vegetative state. In other words, he can't move or communicate. He probably knows what's going on out here, but there's no way he can answer you. His body won't function. And it just happened with something he ate. A piece of fish did that to him. That's why I warn people about sushi. Be careful. Make sure it's good and cooked. That's all I can tell you. You eat raw fish and you might be in trouble, you know. You never know what you're going to get. I try not to eat anything raw myself. But that's the kind of thing. You see, when the Lord came seeking those who were misfortune, the poor, the out, the sinner, the sickly, those that needed help and couldn't help themselves. And the Lord was saying, what he was saying is, there are people in this world that can take care of themselves. There are people in this world that's responsible for their actions. There are people in this world that can get to church on their own. There are people in this world that can do things for the church. But I'm telling you right now, there are people out there that would do things for this church if we could just get them here. And the Lord sent his disciples out and said, go in, basically go into the highways and the hedges and compel them to come into my house. And he said, go to the sick and the maimed. Go out there to anybody who will listen and bring them in. And I think that's one of the key verses that brought about bus ministries in the churches. The command to go out and bring them in. How are you going to bring them in? Well, we can bring them in our cars. But you just can't get people to do that. Get everybody in here, stop by and pick up at least one person. The church will be full today. But since people didn't do it, we got bus drivers and sent out buses and picked up the people, the poor, the children, people who couldn't get here on their own, and the maimed and the lame, and we brought them in. And so Jesus came like that. To understand what's going on, you'd have to understand a little bit about Bethlehem. The Lord was born in Bethlehem. That was the city of David. Now, if you've ever been to Jerusalem, you probably, or Israel, Jerusalem for sure, but you'd probably know about Bethlehem. At the time of Christ, Bethlehem was just a small little village. But today it's a big city. It's an Arab city where a lot of Arabs live in Bethlehem. And it's about 7 or 8 miles from Jerusalem to Bethlehem. Because these Jews wouldn't go through Samaria, they would take the long route through the mountains. And that 7 or 8 mile journey from Nazareth would wind up being about 80 or 90 miles. And so, and they would travel that on foot. Now, you got to remember that if this situation was taking place today, it'd be entirely a different situation. In fact, this big, large, huge city full of people, business, all kinds of wealth there and things of that nature, and lots of people coming and going from Bethlehem. And they would stop, and in there they would find a place to stay. There would be hotels. You'd have your Hyatt and Regencies and Hiltons and Ramadas and all those things just waiting on you. But in the time of Christ, this little Jewish village made famous only because it's the birthplace of David. You see, God had to do something here to bring all this about. And what God did is he said, well, it's time. He laid it on the heart of King, Caesar of Rome, to put on a taxation so that the people in these other Roman cities would have to go back to their home city to pay taxes. Now, why would God want Mary and Joseph to go back to Bethlehem to pay taxes? Because he knew it was time for Mary's baby to come forth. And according to Micah 2, what's it say? Be born in Bethlehem, the city of David, right? You see it on the screen? And so we find that in order to keep the scripture from being basically torn up or destroyed or making God a liar, that God made sure everything worked out just like it is. And we've talked about this before, that there's a lot of things God would probably do for us, but he can't do it because it would change things. Everything had to be in when the time is right that God would bring this to pass. And everything must have a reason. That's why we have Romans 8:28, where it says, all things work together for good to them that love God and are called according to his purpose. Meaning, no matter what you're walking through or what you're going through, the Lord is going to work that out for good. You say, I can't see how any good comes out of this, and I'm sure that's what Bill Rain said. But when you look at all the health aides that he got to lead to the Lord, and the doctor, and the nurses, I worked around his son, all the opportunities God gave him because his son was in there, God could have took him just like that. Amen. As soon as he ate that fish, we're going home. But God had something coming up here. We're here. He had something coming up here where he needed this situation to get these people in heaven. Amen. And that's the way God works. You'll find that most of your life is by divine appointment when God brings something to your life. Amen. And you're thinking, well, what would God use me for? What would God use Bill Raines for? God will use you in the same way. And not only that, you might be influential in other things. You know, you might be influencing others and encouraging their marriages, helping them stay together, helping with their children, things that you might have input with that you've went through that you could deal or help them get through. I think I always said, you know, I used to, and I go back years, I used to say in my heart, why would people want to have a funeral? Who wants to see you dead? Huh? Who wants to come and say bye to a dead person? If you really wanted to see me, wouldn't you come and see me when I was alive? Huh? But then I realized, God ministered my heart about it and said, you know what, Harry? That funeral's not for you. Amen. It's for those who come to see you. And he said that, I'm going to do something there when these people pass away that I didn't get to do in their lifetime. I told you this, a lot of you, but I got a lot of new people here who've never heard it. But we had a young 15-year-old boy in our youth group that came forward one day, told the Lord, he said, I'd give my life if they'd get saved. And he had a whole list about, I can't tell you, maybe 70 people that he went to school with on that list. There was a bunch of them. It wasn't long after that. He's at Stone Lick Lake. His sister falls out of the boat. He jumps in to try to save her, and he drowns. At his funeral. His funeral was the biggest funeral we ever had at Batavia. People were standing outside. We put speakers outside so the people outside could hear. Couldn't get no more people in the building. And they were all through the parking lot. Invitation was given. And all these people came and gave their lives to Christ. And the pastor didn't think anything about it until he was sitting at his desk one day that week. And he seen that prayer request list laying there. And then he seen all these decision cards that were made at this funeral. They had a regular service at his funeral. That's what he wanted. And he went down them. And he started checking them off. Don't tell God you do something and not be willing to do it. God used every situation for good. It was a bad thing that a 15-year-old boy would have to die. But now how many people's going to heaven because of it? And that's what God may be doing something like that. And then here we find when Jesus came, this was a terrible thing, a dirty, nasty stable. Who could be there? And I want to iterate right here, I guess, that the stable was probably worse than a garbage dump. If you went in there, I mean, the way it would smell and the unclean animals, I don't think they scrubbed them down every day like we might. And the stuff laying there, you know, and all, it was just a rotten place to leave a baby. But I think God had a purpose. We could say today, in the same situation, if they went there, we'd be, instead of being a, that inn would have been a Holiday Inn. You know? And Americans, you know, when we think about those things, we think about the inn was full. We're thinking about the Hilton. We're thinking about the Sheraton. We're thinking about the Ramada Inn, the Hampton Inn, the Holiday Inn, all those inns, but that's not what these were. Matter of fact, Luke, in his gospel, he uses two different words to describe two different inns. And the one that he uses when he says the Samaritan came along and helped this guy, and he bandaged up his wounds, and he put him on his beast, and he rode him into town and put him in an inn and told them to keep him until he gets well, and if he owes anything, he'll pay it when he comes through the next time. Amen. He said, now that inn was, and he said, you can still go to Bethlehem today. And so you could drive through there, and the tour will stop there at that inn where they kept where the Samaritan took the Jewish fellow who had fallen among thieves. He said, now it's not the original, it's a replica, but it's a little bitty building. It has a little stable beside it where they take you and they tie your horse up. And he said, this inn would have been like a shipmate kind of mattress would have been on the floor. Maybe some straw with a blanket over it. And you would have been allowed in the building to sleep on one of those. Everybody would sleep together. Same room. No hot shower. No inside facilities. You'd have to facility. You'd have to go out in the backyard. I know this sounds strange, but it wasn't that long ago. I was in Kentucky and I stopped at this friend of mine's family's house. They lived in a motor home, and I said, hey, you got a restroom? And they said, in the woods. What? Okay. That wasn't bad, you know. In the woods ain't bad. No, there's still people who don't have them, indoor plumbing. So they have to go to the woods. But they didn't even have an outhouse. You just had to go to the woods. And so I didn't even ask for paper because I know they were going to say leaves. I've been down that route. But there was two words in this one. This little inn was, you know, nothing that any of us would be comfortable in, I can tell you that. But then when you get to this inn where he says there was no room for them in the inn, it was even worse. This inn is not even what you're thinking. This inn was like one person might stay there or two. And they would have a little cave in the side of a mountain they called a stable with a little rock wall plus to supposedly hold your animals in there. And they probably didn't even feed your animals or anything like the other one did. The other one would provide for the animals and give you a little place to lay down. And that was luxury, man. Next to this end that Jesus was born in. The stable. The stable. The Bible tells us in Luke 10:34, it says, And he went to him and bound up his wounds, pouring oil and wine, and set him on his beast, and brought him to an inn, and took care of him. That inn was a luxury hotel next to the one the Lord was born in. You know what's funny about it? I guess it's not funny. But the religious crowd walked right by him. It was Samaritan. Everybody hated the one that stopped to help him. There was a Levite that came by. First, there was a priest. The priest came by and seen him laying there and said, get away from this guy. And then here come a Levite. The Levite said, oh, I ain't messing with that. And then a Samaritan come by and said, uh-oh, I got to help this guy. I got to help this guy. So why were they turned away when they came there? Well, it could have been several reasons. One is it just may have been full. There was no room for them. And it doesn't really go into detail about it. But again, she was pregnant and they may not have wanted to get involved with the hassle. Do you know if that same scenario happened today, she'd still have to walk to Jerusalem? To Bethlehem? You know why? Because she was late in her term and the airlines will only allow you to get on the airplane up to 35 weeks. Unless you have permission by your doctor. So if she would have went and said, I'm going to fly up there and went into the United Airlines or Northwestern or Delta, whatever it may be they had over there, and walked in there and said, I want to fly up to Bethlehem. We're going to pay our taxes. And you're pregnant. How far along are you? Well, I'm 37 weeks. What? No! And they wouldn't have let her on the plane, so she's back in the same scenario. I got to walk up anyhow. Of course, I'm sure they took a car, you know. We just call Uber when we, hey, Hoob, come down, get me up there. Well, I don't know. Maybe you couldn't afford that. But whatever it is, it's still basically the same situation because she was going to have a child, and they didn't want to deal with it on a plane. Maybe the hotel don't want to deal with it either. They're thinking it upset our customers, and I don't know what they would do. And so they just said, well, you can stay, but you have to stay outside in the stable. Well, that's kind of rude and crude, isn't it? But people do that. My point is, why did God allow it? I'll tell you why God allowed it. And I've asked myself this question. And that's because it had to be. It had to be that way. If he's coming to the poor, if he's coming to the weak, if he's coming to the sinner, if he's coming to the down and out, then he's going to have to come to them like they are. If you remember what they said about him, they said, you know, that foxes have holes and birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. Amen. He was poor. He was a carpenter. He was a blue-collar worker. He went out and built things for a living. He probably was the best of his time. He might have been able to make all kinds of money, but you wouldn't know it by the way he lived. And then back in that day, everybody probably had to be their own carpenters. So I don't know how many people would actually hire you, except the rich or the wealthy. They might. Anyway, he found himself in that situation. And my goodness, that could have been. It could have been she was pregnant. It could have been they were poor and couldn't afford a room. We need a place to stay. You got any money? Well, all we got is 2 pence. Got to have 4 to get in here. What? Maybe they have 4 pence. Anybody ever been broke? One time I was just a teenager, 19 years old, I was working in Florida. I was completely broke when I went there. I had to work 8 days, 12 hours a day before I got paid. So I had to survive for 8 days with no money, 1,000 miles from home. You think I was lonely? You think I said, boy, I wish Mom was here. Woo, Mom would take care of this. She's the troubleshooter. Sometimes you get in those situations, and they could have been in a situation like that. They just had to make do with whatever they could, but they kind of felt sorry for her, you know, being pregnant. They said, well, we can put you out in the stable. At least you're out of the wind, and you'll be in that little cave there. It usually stays fairly decent in there. I don't know. Charles Spurgeon gives a lot of his thoughts. And I read a lot of them. But I think that's the way it had to be. One thing is, the Lord was what? He was the Lamb of God, wasn't he?
Amen.
If you were looking for a lamb, where would you go find it? Huh? In an inn? Or in a stable? So when the Lamb of God came here to give its life a ransom, would it have been born in a palace? Or would a lamb be born in a stable? I think a stable. I think it was a picture of something that came to the world to save the world. The Lamb of God has come. When John the Baptist told him, he said, no, I'm not the Messiah. I'm just a voice crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. There's one coming after me that I ain't even worthy to unlatch his shoes. And then when Jesus showed up, he said, behold, the Lamb of God.
Amen.
John knew who he was. John knew it was a lamb that was coming. John knew it was prepared before the foundation of the world that he would give his life a ransom for many.
Amen.
And all you have to do is believe. Just believe. He was born like this because he was king of the poor. He lived like that because he wanted to relate to the poor. I know one of our famous pastors, he used to tell the story how he wouldn't even own a car. He said he just drove the mail truck around campus. And someone said, why do you do that? He said, because these little bus kids look up to me. And what would it look like if they hadn't had anything to eat today and I come driving in a Lincoln? He didn't like the way it looked. Hey, that's a fair point there. I don't like the way TV evangelists look. In other words, what they're saying was true. They'd be sending their money out to poor people, wouldn't they? Huh? Wouldn't Kenneth Copeland, instead of having $1 billion in the bank, wouldn't he be sending $100 out every week to somebody? Here, get you something to eat today. And just constantly allowing God to replenish. You know, he believes it's going to multiply it all this amount. You're going to be a trillionaire pretty soon. You just keep giving that money out. I don't think that's the way God works. He's not the stock market. I think that's the way Kenneth Copeland works. I think that's the way Joe Osteen works. I think that's the way, you know, T.D. Jakes and whatever, Paula White and all them guys and gals. That's what they do. And they talk some little widow lady out, giving them a planting a seed with her grocery money. And then what happens? She goes hungry. They add to their what? Their tank of wealth. Yeah, don't lay your treasure up here, the Bible says. Treasure should be laid up there. So you've got to think about those things. I just don't think you could be a TV evangelist and be honest. It's hard to see. You know, I believe Charles Stanley was a good guy and honest. And I believe Adrian Rogers, one of my favorites. I believe he was down to earth and honest. And they all had church ministries. And they taught right out of their church. And it would tell you that, you know, this broadcast was coming from our pastor, Adrian Rogers, from Bellevue Baptist Church. And then you would have, like, Charles Stanley also from Charles Stanley First Baptist Church of Atlanta, Georgia, or whatever it was, I think. But anyway, if it's a ministry and it's of God, it's going to be a church ministry. If somebody's got a ministry that's named Harry Lusby, that's Harry Lusby's ministry. Yeah. He can do whatever he wants with what you send him. That's his ministry. If I got one that says Delhi Hills Baptist Church Ministry, it's church ministry. And they take care of it. And God works through them. If you never send a penny, God wants you on that channel, the church will take care of it. You'll be on that channel. If God wants you there, that's what's going to happen. But God doesn't always want people there. Third thing, he was born humble. And he had to be humble so people could approach him. If he came like an arrogant king, he'd be unapproachable. And that's a no-no. You see, God had to be approachable when he came to mankind. He came seeking you. He didn't want anything because you didn't have anything. He never came saying, if you'd send me $1,000, I'll let you into my kingdom. He never said that. He said, whosoever will come. Come. That's all he wanted you to do. He's born in that stable because he loved you. And you don't realize what it means when you say no. When someone invites you to accept Jesus and you never have, and you say no, you know what you're saying? I'm more powerful than he is. I'll get saved when I get ready. I can't get saved without me. How many times have you heard people say, when I get good enough, I'll start coming to church? When you think that's ever going to happen? If we had a good church, it'd be bad by the time you got here. I'm sure you'll mess it up somehow. I have many times. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we love you. We ask God you bless today and watch over us. And we thank you for all you do. And Lord, our prayer is today, God, there might be one here lost today, Father. That's the one you died for. Father, I want you to touch that heart right now. Minister to that heart that needs you. And Lord, we thank you. We praise you for it. And we ask you right now all these things, God, in Jesus' name.